Union Geometry Conference, which is supported by NSF, Simons Foundation, and University of Miami. So we are very grateful to the University of Miami administration for the constant support of this event, which has been happening already for 8 years. So let me give an opportunity to the Dean of School of Arts and Sciences to say a couple of opening words. Here he is, Dean Helmut.
Hi, good morning. Welcome to Miami. Some of you who have been here before probably remember me. I tend to open this conference very commonly. It's been running on for a few years already, I think like 4 or 5 years. And it's a pleasure to be here, actually, and a pleasure to welcome you to Miami. I'm not going to talk about the weather because I don't want to be Mr. Obvious, right? I'm not going to say anything about that. But I wanted to say that the administration is very strongly supporting the Department of Math in its efforts to become a center of attention and a center of research in mathematics for the hemisphere, including obviously Latin American countries, but also other countries like Canada. And Miami has a great connection to Europe, so that in that sense we think that we can become the crossroads point for intersection of many different mathematicians that may want to come to Miami probably around this time of the year to do mathematics here. So we're trying to, we're working very hard at getting an institutional commitment to get this done in a more established, formal, and consistent basis, and hopefully soon we'll be able to announce something a little bit more formal to all of you that may give you the opportunity to continue visiting Miami and doing very nice mathematics and listening to great lectures around this time of the year in Miami. So I hope that you enjoy the conference very much and that you take a lot from it, and I wish you the best and welcome to Miami again. Thank you.
So this conference also is dedicated to the 30th birthday of Ron Dunagi. So, and of course, we start with one of Ron's oldest collaborator, Arnaud Bouville from Nice, France. 30 years ago, they did some fantastic work on hypercarrier manifolds, proving that the Fano variety for four-dimensional cubic is a hypercarrier manifold, and studying some of its deformation. And probably, I'll be cute for that, but this probably up to the date is the strongest result in theory of four-dimensional cubics. So, of course, 30 years later, Arnaud will be telling us about some developments in this direction. So let me let you know, Arnaud Bouville from Nice. Arnaud?
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here for the 60th birthday of Ron. We have indeed one common joint paper, a very short one. Some example. Ah, this is bad. sorry. The best thing is to restart the computer. I think when we wrote it, we didn't realize it would have such an importance, and I think it was actually a quite important paper. And I will actually choose the subject, so 50 or 40 years later, we are still talking about hypercarrier manifold. And I chose slightly particular point of view, namely we discuss the showing of this of hypercarrier manifolds. This is something which started essentially 10 years ago by some remarks of Claire Voisin and myself, and which has been developing quite seriously in the last year. So this is what we'd like to survey a little bit what has been done on the subject. So let me first recall what is the Chao Ring. Maybe not everybody knows that. It is a very natural object associated to a complex projective manifold, or more, but that will be my setup. People who don't know should consider it as some kind of cohomology, but defined in purely algebraic terms, not topology at all. Namely, we consider the, what we call co-dimension p cycles. This is just co-dimension p irreducibles of varieties, and we take finite sums with integral coefficients. And this modulo an equivalence relation called rational equivalence, which generalizes in a rather obvious way the linear equivalence of divisors. So I will also, let me mention that I will use also a dimension. Normally, we as a graded ring, the grading is by codimensions, so CHP cycles of codimension P, and I will use the notation a subscript P to indicate a cycle of dimension P. Okay, and the product, the product is given by intersection of divisors. So, for instance, CH naught, codimension 0, we just have X itself, so it's the Z. CH1 is the usual Picard group, and it divides us with your linear equivalence. CH2 is already something very mysterious. You should keep in mind during the talk that we know very little about this Chao group, even if it has been defined something like 100 years ago, essentially by Seferi. This is something we understand very poorly. Let me just give an idea of that. I hope you can read the last slide. If our X has only one non-trivial holomorphic form, then in particular, the group of zero cycles, CH, so this should be CH, maybe we should. CH subscript 0 of X cannot be parametrized by an algebraic variety. It's a huge group. I don't know, okay, I'm not someone can do something about that. Okay, now I want to consider K3 surfaces. What can we say about the Chao ring of K3 surfaces? So I will always be discussing smooth projective manifolds in this talk. And a K3 surface, for instance, I mean, the typical example is a smooth quartic surface in P3, and there are many others. What do we know? We know that the Picard group is just a lattice. There is no continuous part because it's simply connected. So the Picard group is Z to the row. Rho is a number which can take any value between 1 and 20, which is called the Picard number. And because there is a non-trivial holomorphic 2 form on the K3 surface, CH naught is very large. I mean, cannot be expressed as a, I mean, cannot be parametrized by an algebraic variety. So the point of departure of this story is a result we had in 2004 with Pierre Voisin. First of all, I mean, not very surprising, all points of S which lie on a rational curve, and by this I mean possibly singular rational curve, they all have the same class in CH0S. So we have a canonical class called C. So S, and now maybe the more surprising fact is that the intersection product, pick if we take two divisors and we take their intersection, this gives a zero cycle, and this zero cycle is always constant in CH naught. I mean, it has a constant class. It's always a multiple of this CS. So you see that pick S can be up to Z to the 20, so it's not obvious that the rank of the image will be always wrong. And the last result is a comparison with another natural class for any variety. Chan classes can be considered as a cycle. Of course, they limit cohomology, but there is a more refined theory which defines chain classes as element of the Chow group. So in particular, we have a C class C2, which is also of dimension 2, hence in this CH0. And for K3, this class is proportional to our canonical class CS. CS is to be 1, I mean C2 by standard geometric theory has to be 24, so 24 is not surprising, which is not trivial, is the proportionality. Okay, 1 and 2, are actually very easy, so let me give a proof. It's very easy modulo a non-trivial result, which is always attributed to Mumford and Bogomolov, which was carefully written down by Mori and Mukai, which says that on a K3 surface, any curve is linearly equivalent to a sum of rational curves. The intuitive reason, I hope you can read it anyway, we read it. The intuitive reason is the following. Riemann-Horf tells us that the dimension of the linear system spanned by this curve C, all the curves linearly equivalent to C, this is a projective space of dimension, the genus of C. Now, if you have a family of curves of genus G, you expect that imposing one node will give you a G minus one dimensional family. Imposing two nodes give you a G minus two dimensional family. So it's quite natural to expect that you will find at the end finitely many curves of the linear system with G nodes, which therefore are rational. This is not how you prove the result. I mean, I have never seen, I mean, it would be interesting to have a proof along this line. The proof uses the whole package of period maps and for K3 surfaces. Anyway, this is a fact, and now let's accept this this fact, and let me give a proof of 1 and 2. First of all, we want to see that if we have 2 points on two different rational curves, so that's rational curves at R and R prime, we have 2 points P and P prime, we want to show that they are rationally equivalent. Well, even if you don't know the definition of rational equivalence, you can accept that two curves and a rational curve will be rationally equivalent. Otherwise, not much to do. So the problem is to compare these two, the points of these two curves. Now we pick any ample divisor, H, and since H is ample, we meet both curves, R and R prime. And we know by Mumford Bogomolov that there is a divisor linearly equivalent to H, let's call it H prime, which is a sum of rational curves. So we have this situation here. And now you see that P and P prime are linked by a chain of rational curves, and therefore they have the same class in the Chow. This is a proof of one. And to prove two, we have to prove that any intersection of curves gives a multiple of this particular class of points in a rational curve. But we can always replace one of the curves, the C prime, by a sum of rational curves. So we just have to compute an intersection of a curve and a rational curve. And of course, the intersection points lie in the rational curve, so they're all equivalent. They all have the same class, CS in CH0. That's the proof of two. I won't give the proof of three, which is much more involved. Let me just mention that it's an easy consequence of a non-trivial result about the Chow group of S times S times S, S cube. Namely, in this, we have the so-called modified diagonal cycle. We start from the small diagonal, so we take all the x, 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 with x moving in S. Then we take the first diagonal with, we choose a fixed point R, which represents this class CS, the lying in a rational curve. And then we take the partial diagonals this permutation, and then we take just the pullback of the surface. This is called the modified diagonal cycle. And we prove that this is trivial. The cycle is trivial, but the result is pretty non-trivial. And from this, we deduce easily. So to prove this, we use the fact we cannot stay with rational curves. You have to use elliptic curves, again, singular elliptic curves. Let me make two remarks. First of all, this I wanted to mention this vanishing of modified diagonal cycle, because it turns out to be very interesting. And there have been very interesting work recently by O'Grady and Voisin, Moonen and Ying. And they have some very interesting results, and also some very interesting question about it. But this is slightly aside I took today. Another remark, which I would like to insist on, that the theorem 1 is quite particular to K3 surfaces. Maybe just go back to theorem 1. So theorem 1, let's say in particular the assertion 2. So the image, I call this map mu, the image of the intersection product of divisors. And there are examples, recent example again, this is 4 or 5 months ago by O'Grady, as example of surfaces of degree D, smooth surfaces of degree D in P3, with the rank of this image growing linearly with D. So there is no hope that something like that exists for other surfaces. This is very, again, a very particular property of K3 surfaces. Now let me reformulate a little bit this results. Consider the ideal. In this Chow ring, we have a natural ideal, which is the ideal of cycles homologous to zero, meaning that for each P, we have a natural map from CHP to cohomology, to in degree 2P, and the kernel is just the cycles which have trivial homology class, so homologous to zero. This is an ideal of. And let me say that this gives a filtration, a very simple filtration of the Chow ring, with F0 being everything, F1 being this CHX hobby. Okay, I mean, the word filtration is a bit pretentious in this direction. The reason is that we expect this to be part of a larger filtration, which we will see later. Anyway, we have this filtration here. And I claim that assertions 1 and 2 are just the fact that this filtration splits multiplicatively, meaning that we can find a sub-ring, CH0, inside of CH, such that, which is a complement of this CHR. And in such a way that this decomposition is stable under multiplication. Well, this guy here is an ideal, so there is no problem. But the point is that CH naught should be stable by multiplication. Let me spell this out for K3. CH1, there is no divisor homologically trivial. It's already linearly trivial. So CH1 is just peak S concentrated in degree zero. CH2, we split it as this particular one cycle, zero cycle, so we have degree 1, ZCS, plus CH2 arm. CH2 arm just means degree 0 for zero cycle. And our assertions are just that, you know, a product of two elements here, like here. So it just means that we have a multiplicative splitting of this filtration. And the question I would like to address is for which other varieties, this makes me a little bit nervous, for which other varieties do we have such a splitting? Let me look at another very simple type of varieties for algebraic geometers. These are abelian varieties. If we look at the Picard group, so CH1, it's well known and easy that there is a natural splitting, at least if we tensor with Q. Let me now pick this up. Hugh, we have the natural evolution of the abelian variety, which stands a to minus a, and it acts on everything. And so we can split this space as a sum of two eigenspaces, the big plus, which is minus one invariant line bundle, and big minus, which is minus one anti-invariant line bundle. And it's very easy to check that big plus is just injects into cohomology, and in fact, it's just the algebraic part of cohomology. This I don't know how to handle. The way I know is it takes some time. It's just to restart the thing. Sorry about that. Okay, so what I was saying that for CH1, we have just a very natural splitting by taking for what I call CH01, the space of plus invariant divisor classes. Even for doing that, I mean, which is the only natural way to split this this filtration, you have to invert at least two. I mean, this if you want to have this decomposition, this will not work over C. So from now on, I mean, the convention will be that I will pass from to cycles with rational coefficient. CH will mean CH tensor Q. We know very little about the torsion of the Chow group. It's an interesting question, but let's already try to understand what's going on with this CH tensor. And now in this, there is a very nice theorem, maybe not so well known, from O'Sullivan in 2011, which says that indeed there exists a multiplicative splitting for the Chow group from an abelian variety, which of course, as a level of divisors, gives the one I was mentioning before. But what you say is, call this this part, this other mysterious part here, the space of symmetrically distinguished cycles. It's quite, I mean, the paper is about 80 pages. It's really quite involved in so very interesting paper. Anyway, so we have this property for K3, for abelian varieties. Can we go further? Well, you see, if it is already very difficult to do for abelian varieties, where we have a lot of structure, it would probably to be even much harder for a general variety. I mean, how do you isolate inside of CH0 a particular class of cycle, which should be this CH0? That's very difficult. But what I noticed, I mean, again, years ago, maybe 8 years ago, is that there is a weak consequence, which is more easier maybe to check. Let's assume that we have no B1 is zero, which will mean in fact that there is no continuous, no peak zero. I mean the continuous part of CH1X is zero, we only have a lattice. Then this implies a property which is called WSP, the weak splitting property. If we look at the subalgebra of the Chow ring span by divisors, with this assumption here, all divisors are of degree zero for this splitting, and therefore every product should be of degree zero. In particular, degree zero means that it injects into cohomology. So we should have this property here. Or another equivalent, of course, formulation is to say that any time you have a polynomial relation between this divisor, PD1 DK0, in cohomology, the relation should already hold in the Chow group, which is infinitely larger. So it's a rather strong property. This property was refined by Pierre Voisin in our work, which I will discuss now. So she made a stronger question or conjecture with WSP plus. So we would like to ask that the cycle map is injective on the subalgebra spanned by divisor and by the chain classes. And this would include, I mean, this would give, in the particular case of case 3, part 3 of the theorem, which was the value of C2, the fact that the second chain class is proportional to the canonical class. Okay, so this is a property which is maybe possible to check. I mean, again, the Chow group is something complicated. It's not just trivial, but at least there is some hope to do something. So, which are the varieties we can hope to apply? We have K3, we have a billion varieties. So, the natural hope would be to have all Calabi-Yau. This is not true. This doesn't work. And the reason is simple. We have a very simple lemma, which says that every time we have a surjective morphism like that, a map, and we know that the first one, the first one satisfies WSP, then the one below, if I can say so, will also satisfy WSP. And the proof is very simple. It's just a commutative diagram. You see that we have this DCH spanned by divisors, which we assume WSP for X, so this injects into cohomology. Now, whenever we have a surjective map, we have the pullback maps from cohomology and also from the Chow groups, with always with Q coefficients. These maps are injective. Now, if you look at this diagram, the diagonal map here must be injective, and this implies that the horizontal map below is injective. So this is just a very straightforward argument. But it tells you, you know, it's very strong. I mean, if X has this property, anything dominated by X will have it also. And that's very strong. So to give a counterexample, let me start with, let me first give an example of a Fano manifold, which doesn't have this property WSP. And that's very simple. You look at a blow-up of P3 along a curve C of, let's say, of genus 2 degree 5. Any small genus and small degree basically would do. Let me just fix these values of the invariance. And we have an exceptional divisor, E. It's well known that, therefore, the Picard group of the blown-up threefold will be spanned by the exceptional divisor and the pullback of a hyperplane section. And now we look at the square. What are the, I should write this actually DCH2, what are the products of this divisor? We have three classes, B star H square, B star H dot A, and E square. And it's easy to see that if C, actually if the embedding of C is general enough, these three classes are linearly independent. So this has DCH2 as one 3, but on the other hand, let me read what is written because you cannot read. What is before of Y, which the dimension of H4, by Poincaré duality, this is B2, and B2 is the dimension of the Picard group, is 2. So there is, I'm sorry, there is a typo here, it's to be H4, of course. DCH2 maps to H4, but the map is not injective, just for rank reasons. Now, this is not, of course, Calabi-Yau, but it's very easy to build up a Calabi-Yau example from this. You take the double cover of Y branch along any smooth divisor in the linear system, minus 2ky. If the curve is of sufficiently small degree and genus, I mean, you have no problem to find such a divisor. And this is a kind of easy, very threefold. By the lemma that I just gave, the subgroup of CH2 spanned by divisors does not inject in cohomology. Again, it should be H4. Sorry about that. Let me mention, I mean, things are very far from being well understood at this point. Let me mention the result of Pierre Voisin. If we take a hypersurface, X, which is Calabi-Yau, so degree n plus 1 in Pn, then the image of the product will still be of dimension 1. And of course, to be precise, it will be the image will be spanned by the nth power of a hyperplane section. And the same, so this is due to Pierre Voisin, and it was extended to complete intersection by Yefu. Again, a nice feature of the proof is that this modified diagonal cycle appears again now in this Chow group. It's not zero, it's not trivial, but it's simple somehow. It can be expressed in terms of the variety of lines containing heads, and that's enough to give this, this result. Well, a very natural question, I have no idea about the answer, is that is there a larger natural class of Calabi-Yau manifolds for which this property here holds itself? I don't know. So let me go to my subject. Maybe. So there's absolutely no hope to extend these properties of splitting filtration, I mean, multiplicative splitting for all Calabi-Yau. So what is the natural generalization of K3? Well, that's what we call hyperclear variety. So now let me hyperclear manifolds, go to the heart of the subject. And the conjecture, which we try to give some evidence at least for this, is that WSP and the stronger property WSP plus should hold for projective hyperclear manifolds. What is hypercolor is also called sometimes irreducible holomorphic symplectic, HS. So this means simply connected, and we want the space of holomorphic two form, H not omega 2, to be spanned by one holomorphic two form, R, no, come on. So, there is something we should do, but. Okay, I'll start because otherwise it would take too long. So it's spanned by a two form which is symplectic in the sense that it's always non degenerate at every point. This is a very natural generalization of K3 surfaces, and this is a very nice object, which we discuss. Okay, here we are. So, many of you know, there has been a lot of work on hypercolor manifolds this last year, many interesting properties. The slightly embarrassing feature is that we had very few examples. In fact, up to deformation, we have essentially two series in each dimension. Let me recall what they are. First of all, we start from a K3 surface, and we look at it's called S bracket N. So this parametrizes the subscheme of length N, so finite subschemes of length N of K3S. If you are not too familiar with the subscheme, just think of this as a set of N elements, essentially, of S. But you have to take care, I mean, when it's N distinct points, it's fine. if some points come together, you have to take care of the way they come together. So it's not exactly the symmetric product, Cmn S, which would be just what I said, the variety of sets of n elements. This is actually a desingularization of this symmetric product. So this is one example. The second one is done in an analogous way. And it's called generalized Kummer variety, sometimes it's called Kn, starting from an abelian surface. You just have an abelian, I mean, if you just take the Hilbert scheme, it will not be simply connected, so you have to do something very simple to get this Kn. And there are, I'm sorry, probably not, I'm sorry for Kieran already, probably not this, there are two sporadic examples in dimension 6 and 10, which are different from those. And which were discovered by the grid. That's all we know in some sense, but let me go to this matter of deformations. I'm talking only about projective hyperkeller manifold in this talk. So let me recall that, first of all, what is the situation with K3 surfaces? For each genus G, or number G, we have a 90-dimensional modular space, Fg, which parameterizes projective K3 surfaces, S in Pg. So for instance, we have quartic surfaces in P3, intersection of a quadric and a cubic in P4, intersection of three quadrics in P5, and so on. This goes for forever. So these are countably many families of projective surfaces. Now, of course, we can, for each of these families, we can form this S bracket M. But they will not be general in their deformation space. Their deformation space has dimension 20, and so the general element is not of the form S bracket M. We say this is a challenge for algebraic geometers because it's something we should be able to do. We are not looking at abstract compact manifold, we are looking at projective manifold, but we are not able to, in general, to describe these guys. So the terminology, which is sort of standard now, is that we say X is of type K3 M if it is deformation equivalent to some S bracket N, and similarly it is of type Kn if etc. So the question is, can we describe complete families, which mean 20-dimensional families, of projective varieties of this type? We started to some examples, or I should, of course, quote the example we found with Juan 30 years ago, something like that. We start with a smooth cubic fourfold in P5, so, and we look at the variety of lines. It turns out that this variety is four-dimensional, it's smooth, and is of type K3 bracket, which means that it can be deformed, it can be specialized to, in some cases, some special cubic give rise to a variety of lines which is exactly S bracket 2. But of course, the cubic has 20 moduli, and therefore it's a more general family. And for a long time, this has been the only example known, but now we have many examples. Well, many, not so many. There is one family constructed by O'Grady, so-called double EPW sextic. One was constructed, I guess, before, but it's not probably chronological, at EEF and Adestad. There is also an example by De Bar et Voisin. All of these are of dimension 4, correspond to N2. And recently, there has been an example by EEF, the two Kapuska and Adestad, with N equals 3. And one by the two Lane, Sorger and von Straten, N equals 4. But still, I mean, it's very, we should have countably many families, and this is very mysterious. I should point out, like, for many questions, in particular about the Chow-ring, deformation is not sufficient. I mean, you can certainly not deduce a statement about showering by deformation, because usually, let me add also that for the Coomer case, the generalized Coomers, we have absolutely no example of complete family. I mean, no explicit example. Deformation theory tells us that they exist. So let me start with the result about this WSP conjecture. In fact, in this case, it's WSP plus. And so the work of Kervezin from, I don't know, maybe 4 years ago, something like that. If you take a K3 surface, and so the first approximation would be to say that WSP plus holds for Sn, at least for n less than or equal to 8, which is already quite good. But she has a more interesting statement involving a number which I call tau, which is the rank of the transcendental part of H2. So this is just a complement of the Picard lattice. This is 22, the second Betti number, minus the rank of the Picard group, so which I called the rho before. And the exact statement is that WSP plus holds for S bracket n for this in this range. The idea is quite interesting. She used work of De Cataldo Migliorini describing the Chow group of S bracket n to reduce to a statement about the usual product Sn. And the statement is somehow analogous. Now I call this DDCH. This is a subgroup of the subrings, the subalgebra of the Chow ring, generated by divisors and pullbacks of diagonals. So D is for the first D is for divisor and the second D for diagonal. Again, we would like this to inject into cohomology, and she proved that if you can prove that, then you get the WSP plus, and in fact, even with a shift, this is not a typo here, the result for n less than 2 tau plus 1 gives WSP plus for n less than 2 tau plus 4. There is a small argument about symmetry which gives that. So, how do you prove that? She writes down a complete list of relations between these generators of this ring DDCH and check that they hold already the relation. So this is relation, sorry, not very clear. The relation, you write the relation in cohomology, which is relatively easy because cohomology is well understood. So you take these guys, the divisors and the pullback of diagonals, you write down all the relations that satisfy in cohomology, and you check that they already hold at the level of Chow ring. This is doable, it's not far from trivial. Very interesting remark. I mean, I remember discussing with her at that moment about this limitation here, and she was explaining that she had tried to do better, but it was some kind of obstruction that she didn't understand very well. And this obstruction was analyzed very nicely by Ke Zhengyin. Can we go to 2 tau plus 2, just one more, I mean, it doesn't look too much to us. But in fact, he proved that this could be equivalent to this statement here, which I put between quotation mark, which tau plus 1 of H2 transcendental should be 0. Now, of course, H2 has, as you mentioned, tau, so you expect that it's wedge tau plus 1 will be 0, but this is in the sense of Chow motifs. I have no time at all to explain that. It's a very interesting theory. The fact is that, so that would mean that the Chow motif of S is finite dimensional. And this is one of the maybe most interesting conjectures in that by now about the theory of Chow motifs. Kimura conjectures that all Chow motifs are finite dimensional, I mean of projective or associated to projective varieties. This is certainly very hard to prove, even for K3. So don't try to one step further, I think that would be very hard. Okay, so that's the result for case 3. Let me mention some other result. That was WSP plus. WSP is very likely, let me say, to be true for S bracket n, for every n. And there is this is actually work in progress of Maulik and Voisin. I mean, Claire Voisin told me that she said, absolutely no problem, so I believe her. This is a very nice idea of Maulik, using the action of the so-called Heisenberg type algebra developed by Nakajima in particular. Okay, about Kn, well, in that case we have WSP plus, so the stronger conjecture due to Yefu. For the, this is the Fanova varieties of a line in a cubic threefold, this one from the cubic fourfold, by Claire Voisin, and also for a general double EPW 60 by Ferretti. This is what I was saying, but beware that the Chow group is absolutely not stable under deformation, so let me read what is content here if I can. If you know WSP or WSP plus for S bracket n, that implies absolutely nothing for type K3 n in general. I mean, you cannot compute, use it to prove anything about this. So in contrast, so all the results we have, all the results I quoted here, are special for special type of hyperkeler and using the particular geometry of hyperkeler. Now I would like to mention a result of Ulrich Eris, a student of Daniel Brecht, which has the advantage, I mean, certainly not far from complete, but it has the advantage of applying to a large class of variety, namely all the hyperkeler of type K3n of Kn, with the restriction that the Picard group should be at least 5. And so she has WSP. I'd like to give an idea of proof. I should recall that for any hyperkeler carries a special quadratic form on H2, which is purely topological, with a property that, which is here. I mean, you have naturally a multilinear form of for degree n, I mean, just taking the alpha to the alpha to the 2n, and this multilinear, this polynomial form of degree n for hyperkeler turns out to be extremely degenerated. It's just the nth power of a quadratic form Q. Okay, the Ries theorem has an easy part, which actually I had done a time ago, and the hard part, which he did. So let me explain the easy part. The easy part is that if we look at the kernel of the symmetric product of peak X, so this is just, I mean, we are looking at what divisor span now in cohomology. We look at the kernel. And this is, of course, an idea, but it's spanned by the classes d to the n plus 1. The hex is of dimension 2n. So this is spanned by these classes for in the complex Picard group, pick x tensor C, with q equals 0. So it's essentially due to Gomolov. So, what says WSP? WSP tells us exactly that classes in this kernel, so it's a polynomial in divisors which vanish in cohomology, the polynomial should vanish in the Chow group. So since this ideal is spanned by these classes, we just have to check that these classes satisfy Dn plus 1 in the Chow group tensor C. Now the Chow group tensor C is not very, not a very pleasant object, but this is where we use the hypothesis on the Picard group. We look at if rho is 5, a quadratic form of Frank at least, I mean, is in at least 5 variables as always, a non-trivial zero. This is called, I think, Meyer's theorem. And so this quadric has at least one rational root point, which implies that it has a lot of rational points. Once you have a rational point in a quadric, you project from this point, and you get rational points are dense. And this implies, because you want to prove something algebraic here, so this implies that it suffices to do it for now divisor in the Picard group, not in Picard tensor C, but in the Picard group. So isotropic divisor should satisfy the n plus 1 zero. So that's the easy part. Or the hard part, so she uses work of Jan Markman, Matsushita, Bayer Makri, and so on. And you reduce to prove in a particular case where D comes from a so-called Lagrangian or birational Lagrangian vibration. So you have a situation. This is X prime is another hypercalor variety. You have a birational isomorphism between X and X prime. And now X prime has what is called a Lagrangian vibration. So it goes to Pn, and the general fiber is an abelian variety, and the fibers are Lagrangian. And so, again, by hard work, she reduces to prove this when we have the pullback of the linear sections on this P. But of course, now this pullback to the n plus 1 is 0, because we are in Pn, so h n plus 1 is 0. The n plus 1 is a pullback by field this class. And there is, again, non-trivial, but for a birational symplectic isomorphism like that, if you you have actually an isomorphism of the Chow, so this implies what we want. Okay, so this is about this WSP property. And, when I did this work, I was very optimistic, and I try to get something more. This is now what I would like to explain briefly. I have to introduce what is called the Bloch-Bellin sum filtration, which is conjectural. Remember that we had this one-step filtration with cycles homologous to zero. And, the game was to try to find a multiplicative splitting of this filtration. Well, this filtration is part of a conjectural equation that should exist for every smooth projective manifold with these properties. I mean, this is, of course, a decreasing filtration. F1 should be just the cycles homologous to zero, and it should end at Fp plus 1 like this. It should be functorial for pullback, pushdown, and multiplicative Fp times F. Should go to Fp plus q. This is a very natural object when you work with cycles. I mean, for instance, I mean, doing some experiment, you see that if you take the product of two cycles homologous to zero, you get something worse than just homologous to zero. I mean, you get deeper in the structure of the Chow ring. So this should be more in F2. This is what, and so on. I mean. Okay, so the hope, again, I don't dare to call this a conjecture, I mean, it's not enough evidence. The hope would be that for HK, this filtration, assuming that it exists, should have, again, a multiplicative splitting. So we should have a situation like that, a grading of the whole Chow group, going to, from, for instance, for good dimension P, for CHP, it would go from CH0 to CH parenthesis P, and the filtration would consist in taking the last part of the grading. I didn't have very much evidence when I asked the question. I didn't write down a conjecture. I asked the question, but I think now Kervazin has some. We say some evidence in the case of the zero cycle, the group CH0. So we'd like to explain this in the remaining time. In fact, what she constructs on CH0, on the group of the recycle, is another filtration which should be, by all means, opposite to the Lord-Bennison filtrations. Let me first remark that at one property which is expected from the Lord-Bennison filtration is that the graded object GRP, so FP over FP plus 1 for CH0, should be controlled by the space of holomorphic P forms. This elaboration of what I said, once when you have holomorphic forms, you get a large part of CH0, so that could be with. Now for HK, we just have, I mean, the only holomorphic forms we have are the symplectic form and its forward. In particular, we don't have odd, nothing here when P is odd. So the filtration should actually be from even somehow from F0, F2, up to F2n. So she defines another filtration, S dot of CH0, which should be, as I say, opposite to F0. And this is very simple in some sense, and very geometric. First of all, for any point of X, consider the orbit of X for rational equivalence, so the locus of points which are rationally equivalent to X. This is not a sub-variety, but this is almost as good. This is a countable union, it's not difficult. It's a countable union of closed sub-varieties, Z of X, which are now the property of being isotropic. When we restrict the holomorphic two form to Z, you find zero. This goes back to the idea of Mumford. I mean, Mumford was the first to prove that CH0 is very large. He did it for surfaces when you have at least one holomorphic form, and he used exactly this kind of argument. In particular, you see the dimension of this orbit, OX, can go from 0 to n, but not more. Okay, now we define SIX as this locus of points in X which have a large orbit, large meaning dimension at least I. So S0 will be, so this will give you a stratification of X. S0 is everything, then S1 is zero, but to Sn, Sn consists of points which have, for which the orbits are Lagrangian, isotropic of dimension n. And then we take the corresponding filtration of CH0, CH0 are just zero cycles, just a sum of points. We just take the zero cycles whose points are all in this SR. And this gives now a filtration of CH0. So for example, let's go back to the K3 case. What is S1? These are the points which have an orbit of dimension 1. There is at least one curve of points which are rationally equivalent to this X. But it's very easy to prove that this means exactly that the class of X is CS. Again, you cross with an ampli divisor, something like that. So this S1 generated by those special points will just be QCS, the complement of CH0 hum. And so the conjecture of the fact that the filtration F dot and S dot are opposite. So technically, this means something like that. You can see that the Lord-Bennison filtration should go to the end, and the Voisin filtration should take the first terms. This would automatically give the grading of CH0. So this is again very hard to check because we don't know the Lord-Bennison filtration. The precise definition of the S filtration, but in general, we don't know what is the F filtration. But there are some cases where we have this. She proves that the conjecture holds for S bracket n. In this case, we have a description of and also for the FV3, the Fanova variety of lines in the cubic fourfold. In both cases, we have an explicit description of the block Benson filtration. So this is what she proved. Again, unfortunately, we need to use really the geometry of this particular variety, the explicit description of this S filtration. I think I will stop here. Say again, which
way? This
is for case 3, actually. It could, I don't know. I mean, this is, you know, this is very much related to the Hilbert scheme. We have defined some algebraic operators somehow on the Hilbert scheme and nested. Like that, and you look how they act on the childhood. So, nothing is known about general molecular. This is really the fact that you are on the bigger scale.
More questions?
Yes. You mentioned a result of Voisin and then Fu about how the surfaces or the sections, I assume that means.
Generic or in projective space? I think this is for all smooth.
But the question is, the obvious generalization is what about hypersurfaces of a given section before it goes?
Don't ask me. I'm not a Tory guy.
Nobody
I don't think so. I don't know that I
know.
Well, Toric people should definitely look at that.
Other questions?
What is the reason the weak splitting property is easier for the one concept?
Yeah.
What is the
Oh, uses a lot the structure of the char ring of abelian varieties. I mean, there is a decomposition of the char ring. I did some long time ago, and I mean that gives a lot of structure, so we use this. You mean to prove WSP?
What is that mean?
This is for KN varieties, so that's a you start from an abelian surface and you good question.
Because in the
K3, Voisin
relates
to the same. It's not, actually, the proof is rather simpler than Voisin's proof. It's not the same method, I think. But I don't know exactly. I don't want to say something wrong.
Any more questions?
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.